Our next symbiosis deals with something that happens in an aquatic environment. The Hawaiian bobtail squid has a special light organ which emits light. This is thought to help the squid with hunting prey and in avoiding predators, as the light mimics the ambient light, camouflaging the squid and preventing formation of shadows. This is an example of bioluminescence, but it's not produced by the squid itself. Inside the light organ is a biofilm of bacteria that can produce light under certain conditions. The major species is Alovibrio fischeri, a gram-negative curved rod. It's able to carry out a reaction where the luciferase enzyme catalyzes the conversion of luciferin to oxyluciferin and light. I just wanted to show you, this squid is extremely tiny and extraordinarily cute, as well as forming a cool symbiotic relationship with bioluminescent bacteria. Alovibrio fischeri cells in the ocean are able to inoculate the light organs of juvenile squid and certain fish. In the light organs of the squid, ciliated cells inside selectively draw in these bacteria. These cells promote the growth of the symbionts and reject any competing bacteria. The Alovibrio cells cause these cells to die off once the light organ is actually full enough of bacteria. If the bobtail squid doesn't come in contact with these bacteria, the crypts of the light organ will remain uncolonized. No other types of bacteria, none of the millions of other species that are present in the sea, will get inside. Each morning, the squid expels most of its bacteria by venting most of the contents of these crypts into the seawater. This allows the remaining bacteria to repopulate the crypt within the next 12 hours. This is beneficial. It allows the squid to actually burrow under the surface sand layer at the beginning of the day without being observed. The light organ is reconstituted just in time for hunting and hiding at night. The bacteria that are released into the sea are able to colonize newly hatched squid light organs. These bacteria only carry out the reaction in the light organ, not when they're free living in the water. Why is this the case? Light production in these bacteria is regulated by quorum sensing. Quorum sensing is sometimes referred to as cell density dependent gene expression or diffusion sensing, because cell density and the amount of signal that's present around the bacteria determine whether or not certain genes will be expressed. The signal is often called an autoinducer, and there are a few well-studied major classes of chemicals that are known to do this. Probably the best known one, and the one that's involved in this particular symbiosis, is the acyl homoserine lactone, or AHL. AHLs can easily diffuse in and out of cells, and concentrations of AHLs inside bacteria will rise if enough bacteria making this signal are close by. The AHL acts as an inducer for transcription for quorum sensing regulated genes. This type of regulation means that Alovibrio fischeri cells will only produce light when cell densities are high in the light organ environment. Quorum sensing is a type of transcriptional regulation for what are considered to be group behaviors in bacteria. Bioluminescence, formation of biofilms, and production of some virulence factors in infection are all examples of things that are associated with having a large number of bacteria in close proximity to one another. There are many other types of bacteria, and even some archaea, that use quorum sensing. Virulence genes in Pseudomonas aeruginosa and Staphylococcus aureus are under quorum sensing control. The Lux operon in Alovibrio fischeri may be the best studied quorum sensing system. In this bacterium, light production genes are found in the Lux operon. There are two enzymes that it can be produced, encoded by a total of 5 genes. The Lux A and B genes encode for the luciferase enzyme. An aldehyde is regenerated by a second enzyme, aldehyde reductase, which is encoded by the genes Lux C, D, and E. The regulation of transcription through quorum sensing involves regulatory genes and products, LuxI and LuxR. LuxI encodes the acyl homoserine lactone signal, and LuxR is an activator protein. Once concentrations of the AHL are high enough, the activated LuxR protein binds to a sequence upstream of the Lux operon called the Lux box, and this is an activator binding site. Once it's bound to the DNA, LuxR interacts with the RNA polymerase to allow transcription of the Lux operon. So we see differences when the cell is grown at low cell densities and they don't have a lot of the quorum sensing signal compared to when there are high cell densities. There's typically a threshold that has to be reached for transcription to occur. In this online lecture, we've just looked at a small subset of topics in microbial ecology. There are many other things that are currently under study. There are many other types of microbial interactions with other organisms, some of which we would consider to be good and others that we would consider to be bad. Bioremediation is the process by which pollutants and toxins can be degraded or neutralized by organisms, and these are typically bacteria. Recycling of things like wastes or organic materials into usable products is something that is also being studied, so this includes things like waste treatment and composting. And there are individuals who are also looking at the impact and potential use of microbes in climate change. A relatively new area of microbial ecology is looking at the microbiology of the built environment. This subdiscipline looks at the complex ecosystems of our homes, schools, workplaces, and other constructed environments, including the subway.